Hallelujah. It's again a great joy even to meet you through the short time of meditation. Welcome to the place where you learn the Bible. Even today, we are going to do another character study. We are going to study about another individual who had a mighty impact, who teaches us great lessons on how to live and on how not to live. As a beginning to our meditation, let us read a few verses from the book of Philippians, from Apostle Paul's letter to the church at Philippi. Philippians chapter 2, verses from 19 to 24. Philippians chapter 2, verses from 19 to 24. I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, that I also may be cheered when I receive news about you. Paul is writing to the church at Philippi. Verse 20. I have no one else like him who will show genuine concern for your welfare. For everyone looks out of their own interests and not those of Jesus Christ. But you know that Timothy has proved himself, because as a son with his father, he has served with me in the work of the gospel. Just as a son with his father, Timothy, he has served with me, Paul, in the work of the gospel. Verse 23, I hope therefore to send him as soon as I can, as soon as I see how things go with me. And verse 24, finally, and I am confident in the Lord that I myself will come soon. Here, Apostle Paul is talking about a man called Timothy. And in verse 22, when we read, he addresses him as a son. He compares Timothy as a son and sees himself as a father to Timothy. You know, many Bible scholars, the verses from the Bible, they say Paul was an unmarried man and he never had any biological children. But here Apostle Paul is calling Timothy, or the only person in the Bible whom Apostle Paul called as a son, is this Timothy himself. So Paul calls him as a son, and he gives him a great certificate. I personally feel, after studying the life of Paul very closely from the book of Acts till his last letter in to Timothy or Titus, one thing that I realized is the Apostle Paul had a great impact even as he lived on this earth. And I do not know how great a preacher he was, because I never listened to him personally. But seeing the way he wrote, the letters that he has written, they are amazing. It is not just that it is spirit-filled, but these are letters that comes out of his heart. And when such a man gives a certificate of value, whatever he says, his words are of value, and he gives Timothy a great certificate, some great words of appreciation. Look at verse 20. He says, for I have no one like-minded. I'm reading this from NKJV, because most of the versions say that there is no one else like him. Most of the versions, you just use this word, that there is no one else like him. But NKJV and NASB, these two versions say like this, including KJV, they say, for I have no one like-minded who will sincerely care for your state. In other words, Apostle Paul, when writing to the church at Philippi, he says, he is the Timothy, my son, is the only person who is in oneness of mind with me, who has the same mind that I have, who has the same burden that I have, who has the same vision that I have, who has the same purpose that I have, who has the same goal that I have. You know, too many people worked with Apostle Paul. A few months back, I was doing a study on all the accomplices of Paul, all the friends of Paul, and from the book of Acts and all through the letters, I could write down around 108 to 109 names. So they were all just the named people, and there were many people who worked with Paul and were left unnamed. So with their names given in the Bible, there are around 108 to 110. So, but approximate 100 people, there is only one man who could get this kind of certificate from Paul, saying He is the only one who is in oneness of mind with me. I think that is amazing. That is amazing when any top church leader or spiritual leader, if they come and tell you, if they give you a certificate about you like this, I'm sure, you know, you will be over the seventh heaven. Paul gives such a great certificate to Timothy. And look at verse 22. He says, you know that Timothy has proved himself. Timothy has proved himself. He has proved himself that he is really a man of God. And then he says, he has served with me just like how a son would work along with his dad. Son is work along with his dad. So this was the kind of praise and adoration that Timothy was getting from Apostle Paul. And it was this Timothy that Apostle Paul wanted to send to the church at Philippi. So Paul wanted to send his son, the man who is like-minded like him, to the church at Philippi. And in verse 19, when we read, it says, I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon. And then in verse 23, he writes again, he says, I hope therefore to send him as soon as I see how things go with me. So Paul, first he gives a great certificate about Timothy, and then he says, I want to send this son, this man Timothy, to you soon. But then something goes wrong in the middle, that he is unable to send Timothy. He's to send Timothy, because in verse 23 he says, I want to send him to soon, but let's see how things go with me. I do not know what was going on with Paul that Paul was unable to send Timothy to the church at Philippi. Now, Philippi was a church which was very close to his heart, because when you read Acts chapter 16, it was to this Philippi that God forced Paul by stopping Paul from preaching in various places. So Paul wanted, when you read Acts chapter 16, Paul wanted to preach in Phrygia and Galatia, but the Holy Spirit stopped him. He blocked his route, and then he wanted to go to Bithynia. Again, there the Spirit of Jesus stopped him. We read this in Acts chapter 16. And then after a few days, he gets a vision from a man from Macedonia asking for help. So Paul understands that this is the call of God. So Paul goes there, and there he meets a lady by the name Lydia at near a river. And she is the first European convert, and that it was through her, and then their jailer who gets converted. So it was through these two that the church at Philippi gets established. So Philippi is a church that is very close to his heart. So he wanted to send Timothy, his son, personally, but then the situations weren't favorable, so he couldn't send him. So now Paul had to choose the next best candidate to send to this church at Philippi. And this next best candidate is going to be the character for our Bible study. A person by the name Epaphroditus. And you know, this is a name which many Christians, though however traditional or however old or however matured they would have been, very few would have heard about this name. And let me tell you, a name which is so very tough to pronounce. I spend almost an entire 2 to 3 hours, you know, trying to, you know, I kept on saying this name, because before preaching, I had to go out to a place where I was driving for around, I was going in my bike for around 45 minutes, and the only name that I kept on repeating in my mouth was Epaphroditus, because I do not want to make a mistake of pronunciation. I don't know how to pronounce, so I went to Google and I asked, you know, how to pronounce the spelling, and Google helped me out. So today I'm going to talk about a man by the name Epaphroditus. So let us read about him even before we go further. Verses from 25 to 30. Verses from 25 to 30. We saw in verse 24. Verse 23. He says, "I'll send it to you. Send him to you. But let's see how things go with me." And verse 24. He says, "I'm confident in the Lord that I myself will come soon." And then in verse 25, he says like this. "But I think it is necessary to send back to you Epaphroditus, my brother, co-worker, fellow soldier, who is also a messenger, whom you sent to take care of my needs. And in verse 26, he says, for he longs for all of you and is distressed because you heard he was ill. Verse 27, indeed he was ill and almost died. You know, last week we were discussing on Dorcas, who was also ill, but she died. And this guy, Epaphroditus, who was ill and almost died, but he didn't die. And then in verse, but then it says, but God had mercy on him, and not on him only, but also on me, to spare me sorrow upon sorrow. And in verse 28, therefore I am all the more eager to send him, so that when you see him again, you may be glad and I may have less anxiety. And in verse 29, he continues, so then welcome him in the Lord with great joy and honor people like him. And verse 30, he concludes saying, because he almost died for the work of Christ, he risked his life to make up for the help you yourself could not give me. So, Epaphroditus, a man whose name is so tough to pronounce, a man whose name not many Christians would have heard. So this is the man we are going to study about. Three lessons from him. So before we step into these three lessons, Epaphroditus actually means charming, lovely, or fascinating. And it is taken from the root word of a Greek goddess of love and beauty called as Epaphrodite. So she was a Greek goddess of love and beauties, and Epaphrodite's masculine name is Epaphroditus. So maybe, you know, maybe this guy was a Greek. For sure he was not a Jew. And Peter had many Jews helping him. Paul had many Greeks, pagans, so-called pagans helping him. Scholars say Epaphroditus' parents may have been pagan devotees of this goddess, and maybe therefore named their son in her honor. Maybe his parents were people who were worshipping a goddess, but God chose him. You know, God, you know, all these things never matter to God. God chooses people as he wants, but God chose him and also gives him to Paul. And Paul gives him words of awesome admiration about this guy. Okay, so now let's look quickly at three important lessons from Epaphroditus. You know, even before we go into these 3 points, I have a humble suggestion. I think that every Christian needs to hear these three lessons. Because these three lessons will redefine how gospel reaches this nation. It's very important that you intently even listen to these 3 points, and that we can apply it in our hearts to our lives. So the first point, the first lesson from what we learn from Epaphroditus, number one, he was Apostle Paul's companion. When you read in verse 25, Paul calls Epaphroditus as my brother, my co-worker, my fellow soldier, your messenger. You know, he literally, when Paul uses these words like brother, co-worker, fellow soldier, messenger, Apostle Paul was indirectly telling one thing, that Epaphroditus is my companion. Epaphroditus is my friend. He was my companion. You know, imagine being a companion of Apostle Paul. You know, being a companion of Apostle Paul is not easy. It is actually very tough. Think of his other companions. You know, he and Barnabas, they went along in the first missionary journey. When they went into a town called Lystra, all of a sudden they were worshipped as though they were gods. And the next moment, they were beaten and thrown out of the town, and they were left to die at Lystra. Acts chapter 14. Think of Luke, who was another companion of Paul. When you read Acts chapter 27 and 28, you find him shipwrecked because he traveled and he was with Paul. When you read Acts chapter 16, we look at another companion of Apostle Paul, Silas, was jailed with hands and legs tied. You know, Barnabas, who introduced Paul to the church, when the 11 apostles, when they were scared to come near Paul, when people couldn't believe that Paul was really a changed man, when they were scared to come to Paul, Barnabas was the one who took Paul and introduced to everyone. But finally, at the end of the day,
It was this Barnabas who had to part ways with Apostle Paul because he couldn't go along with Paul's travel plans. Think of John Mark, the enthusiastic young boy in whose house Peter was a pastor having a church. John Mark had to go with Paul. He went on a missionary journey, the first missionary journey, an enthusiastic young guy who was dedicated, devoted to be a missionary. He goes, and all of a sudden in the middle of nowhere, maybe because of the tough Paul's ways, he said, "Man, I'm going back home. I miss my mom." He got homesick and he left everything. He jumped the ship in the middle of the mission and ran home. Think of Apostle Peter, the mighty man who even tried to stop Jesus' death. That guy had to face the wrath of Apostle Paul for not eating along with Paul. You know, Paul was sitting and eating with all the Greeks and Romans and all the pagans, and Peter was sitting along. And when some of the Jews entered, as soon as the Jews entered, as soon as the circumcised entered, Peter got up from there and Paul blasted him. You know, Paul was not an easy person to live with. Let me tell you, Paul was not an easy person to live with. Not being a Paul's companion was not easy. Maybe, you know, Timothy was one person who had good relationship with Paul. Maybe, you know, I think one of the reasons why Timothy could tag along so well with Paul was because of the age difference. You know, Paul was like a father to him. Timothy was like a son to him. The age difference was great. But here, Epaphroditus is not called as a son. He's called as a brother. Yet, he was Paul's companion. He could have traveled with Paul in his mission journeys, in his life journeys. Paul calls him a brother who could stay with him, a brother who could share his place. Paul calls him as a fellow soldier, a warrior who could fight along with Paul. Paul calls him a fellow worker, a worker who could labor along with Paul. Paul calls him as a fellow messenger, a preacher who could preach along with Paul. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? You know, Paul, he was not just Paul's companion, but Paul loved Epaphroditus so much that in verse 27 he says, he was ill and almost died. And because God, and Paul writes it to the next verse, he says, by God saving, by God stopping Epaphroditus' death, God had mercy on me. But God had mercy on him, not on him alone, but also on me, to spare me sorrow upon sorrow. He said, man, if Epaphroditus had died because of that sickness, I have been in deep sorrow. But God did not just have mercy on Epaphroditus, but he also had mercy on me. Epaphroditus, a man who served God, a man who worked with Paul, but also a man who went to the gates of death through sickness. A man who went to the gates of death through sickness. This teaches us something very, very important. Very, very important. Serving God does not exclude us from suffering. Let me repeat to you again. Today there is too much of prosperity gospel out there. But today I want to tell you something. Serving God does not exclude us from suffering. We can pray asking God, Lord, let me not suffer. But serving God and worshiping God is never a license that we'll never have suffering. You know, this man almost dies, but God is sovereign. You know, God could have kept him from becoming ill. God could have stopped his death. But in his sovereign wisdom, in his sovereign choice, he did not stop that sickness. He chose not to. You know, there is this one false myth that is widespread everywhere, which says once you are saved, once you love Jesus, once you come into that saving grace of the gospel, life is like rainbows and unicorns. Life is colorful, you know, manna comes from heaven, this will happen, that will happen, all your water will turn to wine and all that. But let me tell you, practically life is not that way. Life is not that way. Jesus was baptized. What happened to Jesus the next moment he was baptized? He was led into a wilderness by the Spirit of God, and the demon came out there, and Mr. Devil himself came out there to try his best to deceive Christ himself. Sufferings and failures can be a part of life, but let me tell you, God is sovereign even over that, and God is faithful enough to restore us. The first point, the first lesson that we can learn from Epaphroditus is this.
He was a companion of Paul, and serving God does not exclude us from suffering. Secondly, when I look about Epaphroditus, this is a very important point that I want to dwell in. He was a member care worker. Epaphroditus was not just a friend of Paul, but he was also a man who was serving Paul, who was meeting the needs of Paul. You know, look at Philippians chapter 4 and verse 18. Here Paul writes, I have received full payment and have more than enough. I am amply supplied now that I have received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent. He is writing to the church at Philippi. I am amply supplied now that I have received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent. The gifts that you sent, Epaphroditus has given it to me. They are a fragrant offering, an acceptable sacrifice pleasing to God. Epaphroditus was a link between the church at Philippi and the mission work of Paul. In other words, we need men like Epaphroditus who will become links between the church and the mission. You know, when we read Exodus chapter 17, we know about this incident where Joshua was fighting the battle and Moses was standing at a mountain top with his hands raised, and he was praying to God. Every time when his hands were raised, Israelites were winning. When his hands came down, Israelites were losing. And chapter 17 and verse 12 of Exodus says like this: Moses' hands became heavy, so they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. Aaron and Hur, two men, they were serving Moses himself. And then it says, the same verse, they supported his hands, one on one side and the other on the other, and the other on the other side. And his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. Joshua was fighting the battle down there, but it was not just Joshua's warfare that was winning the battle. It was not just Moses' hands that were winning the battle, but it was also the work of men like Aaron and Hur. Missionary work is not always just about winning souls, but it is also about caring for the missionary. I think Aaron and Hur did that. Moses was working along with Joshua. Aaron and Hur was working for Moses. Paul was going around and winning souls, but Epaphroditus made a link between the church at Philippi and the mission work of Paul, and he made sure Paul was amply supplied. You know, let me tell you, today's Christendom has many wealthy churches and many poor missions. I am very sorry to say that. You might be a church pastor who's watching this. I'm not going to take back my words. I don't care if today's churches are offended by this statement, but this is the truth. Today's Christendoms have many wealthy churches. Today's Indian Christianity has many wealthy churches and very poor missions. Today there are many wealthy pastors and very poor missionaries. The church at Antioch supported the mission of Apostle Paul. The church at Jerusalem supported the mission of Apostle Peter. And here the church at Philippi supported the mission of Apostle Paul. I think today churches need to arise and support the missionaries who are out there, the missions who are out there. You know, churches cannot, the purpose of church will be lost if the churches are going to be very, very independent and say, we are all independent churches, we will just take care of ourselves. You know, God did not call you like that. You might be a traditional CSI, CNN, Lutheran, Baptist, you might be anybody, or you might be an independent church, you might be a Pentecostal, you might be a CPM, you might be a TPM, whoever you might be. But let me tell you, if the church is not going to support the already existing mission work, it's not going to help the cause. You know, today many churches come out with an idea, say, we will put our missionaries there. Okay, it's well and good, you can do that. But what about the already existing mission organizations? What about the already existing mission workers? What about the already existing missionaries?
The church at Antioch supported Paul. The church at Jerusalem supported Peter. The church at Philippi supported Paul. Now, Antioch was a church which was already existing when Paul came there. But Philippi was a church that Paul formed, that Paul established, and now that church has grown up to such an extent that they were supporting Apostle Paul. And this man, Epaphroditus, became the link between the Philippian church and the missionary Paul. You know, today, if you are praying for revival in your fasting prayers, in your intercessory prayers, but if the church, if the churches in cities, if the churches in towns, if the churches in villages are not ready to stand out and support the mission work that is happening in India, your prayer for revival is a nonsense. It is useless. I'll tell you, praying and not acting is rubbish. We need Epaphroditus to rise up. We need Epaphroditus to rise up. Epaphroditus to rise up. And to form a link. I think, you know, I wish God will bless every mission and church with a link like Epaphroditus. Today that is the need. Today that is the need. You know, today I have seen many people interested in knowing how many souls that this missionary had won. How many souls that this mission leader, this missionary organization has won. But I am very sad that no church, no wealthy Christian, no one is ready to spend time with that missionary and find out how are their children doing, what is happening to their daily needs, what is the source of income. You know, I saw during this pandemic time many missionaries being crushed, many missions losing everything. Today, I'll tell you, missionary work is not just about winning souls. I don't care how many souls a missionary wins if the missionary doesn't have food on his plate. Food in his plate. But Epaphroditus was a member care worker. He was not just a soul winning worker. He was a member care worker. That is why in Philippians 4:8, Paul says, I am amply supplied. Wow. You know, I pray, I wish that every missionary in India, every man of God, every preacher, every evangelist, every prophet, every apostle, every Bible teacher, every child of God, every man and woman who is serving out there in some corner, in some village, in some forest area, in some tribal area, can utter the same words. I am amply supplied now that I have received from Epaphroditus the gifts that you sent. You know, until such a day comes, let me tell you, there is never going to be a revival in India. The revival started in the early church when everybody shared what they have. That is when the revival happened. Not just when prayer was there. When they prayed, the anointing came. But when they shared and lived together, the revival broke out. The revival broke out. You know, Epaphroditus was a man. In verse 25 and verse 26 we read, Epaphroditus was a man who served Paul. In verse 25 he says, whom you sent to take care of my needs. And in verse 26 he says, he writes to the church, he longs to be with you. Epaphroditus was a man who longed to be with the church, but at the same time also longed to take care of the needs of Apostle Paul. I firmly believe that the missing link for revival in India are men like Epaphroditus. That these men are missing. These men are missing. I'm sorry if I use some real tough words, but I just poured my heart out. Epaphroditus, number one, he was a companion of Paul. When men couldn't stand Paul, when men walked out, he stuck to Paul. You know, I'll tell you, it is very easy to stick with God, but it is very tough to stick with man. You know, that is one reason today many ministries are getting split. They are getting broken. You know, though in a way it seems as though it is positive that one ministry divided and became two, and now there are, instead of one church in a street, now there are two churches in a street. In one way, though it looks good, though I don't say it is a good way, but some people say, you know, it's better to have many ministries together, you know. But still, when one becomes two because of division and envy, let me tell you, it never pleases God and it never fulfills the purpose of God.
You know, yes, sometimes men might be hard. Men might be hard. Yes, sometimes your spiritual leaders, your church leaders are tough. But we need men like Epaphroditus who are ready to stick around even though the leaders are tough. Firstly, Epaphroditus was a companion of Paul. Secondly, Epaphroditus was a missing link between the church and the mission. And thirdly, verse 30 says, Epaphroditus, he risked it all. He risked it all. Verse 30, Paul writes, he almost died for the work of Christ. He risked his life to make up for the help you yourself could not give me. He risked it, his life. He risked it all. He was a guy who was not holding things for himself, but he was ready to take the risk. He was ready to walk the second mile. In a place, Jesus says, what gain is it for a man if he gains the whole world, yet loses his very soul? You know, when I think of men taking risk, you know, there are many people who come to my mind. I think of Graham Staines. You know, it was in the year 1999. I think in the month of November, December, India went on a tour to Australia for cricket. And Sachin Tendulkar was leading the team. And India went there and Australia thrashed India 3-0. India lost to Australia 3-0. They played three tests and they lost all the three tests. And then there was a tri-series between India, Australia and Pakistan. There were eight matches. India lost, except for one match against Pakistan, they lost all the rest. And the final was between Australia and Pakistan. India couldn't even go up to the final in that one-day tournament. Australia thrashed India. India was beaten by Australia. But on that same year, a few months earlier, an Australian missionary in India was thrashed and burnt alive by Indian goons. Graham Staines, a missionary from Australia to India. Gladys Staines, Philip, and I forgot the other guy's name. They all came down from Australia to India and they served among the lepers. They worked there. And finally, Timothy, Graham Staines, Philip, Timothy, two young sons and a dad. They were burnt alive. He risked it all. I was wondering when I watched that movie of Graham Staines, which came out maybe a year back. I was wondering, why did this guy from Australia all the way should come and live in the tribal area where there is no proper toilets, where there is no proper water? You know, didn't he think about his children? But Graham Staines risked it all. Here Paul writes, Epaphroditus risked it all. Graham Staines risked it all. Jim Elliot. The story of Elliot is just awesome. You know, when we look at his parents, Fred and Clara Elliot, the Wikipedia says, Fred, the father of Jim Elliot, his family was one of the first to come and settle in America. They had a big ranch, large ranch. His mother was a Swiss lady who came and settled down here. He was a wealthy man who was newly married. Instead of going on a honeymoon tour, he goes out to an uncivilized Aqua tribes of Ecuador. He and his friends, Nate Saint, Ed McCully, Pete Fleming, Roger Yodrin. No man has ever gone there. They go there. Jim Elliot writes in his diary, he is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. He goes there. And even before he could give the first tract, even before he could preach his first message, he is killed. He is killed. All his five friends are killed. But then the wives of all these five men, led by Elizabeth Elliot, the wife of Jim Elliot, they go back. They go back, they say, all my husbands did, they laid out a tract. They showed us the path how to go. Jim Elliot, his friends and their families, they risked it all. They risked it all. And there is this one guy by the name Henry Martin. If you ever have a chance
Go to YouTube and search Ravi Zacharias on Henry Martin. Ravi Zacharias would speak around 2 to 3 minutes on Henry Martin. It's so beautiful. I'm just going to say what I heard from the man, great man, Ravi Zacharias himself. You know, this man by the name Henry Martin, he was a Cambridge scholar, he was studying there. But this guy had a physical infirmity. He had warts all over the body. You know, so people never went near him, in his face, in his hands, in his legs. There were warts everywhere. He had an inferiority complex that he will never go and stand near anybody. He will never go talk to anybody. You know, there are stories where he used to sit in the corner of the classroom, corner of a cricket field. So one day he goes to a church, and there was a missionary who was talking about the mission needs of India. And this Henry Martin, because of his watch, nobody would come near him. But finally there was this one young girl by the name Lydia, who loved him and gave her heart out to Henry Martin. So when nobody wanted to come near him, Lydia comes and loves him and stays with him. But on that very Sunday, when he heard about the need of a missionary in India, he felt as though God is pushing him as a missionary to India. So he goes to this young girl, to his sweetheart, to his lover, Lydia, and says, "I attended this service and I feel a push that I have to go to India. And after getting married, would you come and be with me at least for a brief period of time?" And Lydia says, "That is the last place I want to be ever in my life. That is the last place I want to be ever in my life." Now there is a big tussle within Henry Martin. Should he stay with the only girl who has ever loved him? Or should he follow the vision, the calling that God has for him for India? His heart was pounding. His heart was whether India or Lydia. India or Lydia. India or Lydia. But after giving a lot of thought, he realizes it was not India or Lydia. It was either India or God. India or God. So he comes to India. He works there. And from there he goes to Persia. At the age of 31. His hands and legs are tied to a horse's and he's dragged in the streets, and he is killed. He dies at the age of 31. But before his death, you know what he left for the world? He left a New Testament in 3 languages: Hindi, Arabic, and Persian. Henry Martin, he risked it all. Jim Elliot, he risked it all. Graham Staines, he risked it all. David Livingston, he risked it all. William Carey, he risked it all. Adoniram Judson, he risked it all. Hudson Taylor, he risked it all. Ida Scudder, she risked it all. Amy Carmichael, she risked it all. C.T. Studd, a famous cricketer who left cricket and went as a missionary. You know, he has some of the most powerful quotes. He says like this: "Some wish to live within the sound of a church or a chapel bell. I want to run a rescue shop within a yard of hell." Again, he says another quote: "Only one life, it will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last." A man who risked it all. C.T. Studd says in another place, "If Jesus Christ be God and died for me, then no sacrifice can be too great for me to make for him." He risked it all. Paul says Epaphroditus risked it all. I know today in India there are many missionaries who have risked it all. I know about a lady called Dr. Iris Paul. She risked it all. I know about so many well-educated people, so many bank officials, so many people who are working in education sector, professors, college professors, school teachers, many doctors. They risked it all and they went, and today they serve God there. Now today that leaves us with the third question, or the third lesson. Paul says Epaphroditus risked his life. And now I want to end this with a question to ourselves: what are we risking? What are we risking? We are not even ready to risk a 100 rupee note. You know, you go to a church and there is a call, there is a missionary who is speaking, or there is your church pastor speaking, When the time for offertory comes, you put your hand inside your purse, into your wallet. You find there is only one 500 rupee note. There is no change. There is no 10 rupee, 20 rupee or 50 rupee change. Can you risk that 500 rupees? I do not know. Today, what are we ready to risk? Epaphroditus risked it all. William Carey risked it all. He lost 6 or 7 of his children in India. They all died. His wife became a mad lady. He risked it all. Henry Martin risked it all. Jim Elliot risked it all. Paul risked it all. Jesus risked it all. But today, when it rains a little, we are scared to step out to go to the church. What are we risking? Epaphroditus was a man who traveled, who was a companion of the tough Paul. Paul was tough, but he stuck to Paul. Epaphroditus was a man who was not just a missionary, but he was a member care worker meeting the needs of Apostle Paul, a link between the church and the mission. Epaphroditus was a man who risked everything for the sake of the gospel of Christ. And that leaves us to ponder and to think, how are we? Epaphroditus was a man who just appears in 5 to 6 verses in the Bible. But when what he has done for the kingdom of God is far greater than what today's many church leaders have ever done. May God speak to us. May God make us more committed, more devoted than this one guy by the name Epaphroditus. May God bless you. May God make you more committed. May God help us so that we'll be more sacrificial than Epaphroditus, so that we will accomplish greater things for the kingdom of God. May God be with us, guide us, and guard us. Stay blessed in Jesus' name. Ponder upon these words. Amen.